So this is an articulated skull. It's better to hold the articulated skull from the foramen magnum rather than holding it from the orbits, because the bone on the medial side of the orbit is very thin and might break in the real skull. The skull consists of the cranium and the face. And the cranium, as you can see here, this is the cranial cavity, and the cranium encloses the brain, and the face, as you can see, hangs down below it. The flat bones of the skull consist of a sandwich of cancellous bone in the middle, called diploic bone, between two layers of compact bone. These are the two layers of compact bone, and between them is the diploic bone. The diploic bone contains red bone marrow, and it is drained by large veins. These large veins, they communicate with venous sinuses, dural venous sinuses, that are located inside the skull. And these diploic veins are not accompanied by arteries. The arteries that supply the bones of the skull are derived from the meningeal arteries. These are the grooves of the meningeal arteries. This is the groove for the middle meningeal artery. These meningeal arteries, they supply the meninges and the bones of the skull. Remember that the skull is not supplied by the arteries that are located outside at the, that supply the scalp, so that's why scalping will not result in infarction and death of the bones of the skull, because these bones are supplied from blood vessels from inside of the skull, from the meningeal arteries. There are emissary veins that communicate between the veins outside the skull and the veins or the venous sinuses inside the skull. These are called emissary veins. And for example of an emissary vein is an emissary vein that passes through this foramen. This foramen is called the mastoid foramen, and it communicates between a posterior auricular vein, which is located behind the auricle on the outside of the skull, and the venous sinus here, which is called the sigmoid venous sinus. You can see the groove for the sigmoid venous sinus. Apparently, these emissary veins provide a route for the spread of infection from outside to the inside of the skull. Almost all the bones of the skull articulate with each other by fibrous joints. These are called the sutures. Usually in the adult, there are no movements at these sutures. These are the sutures. There are different kinds of sutures. So most of the sutures are serrated sutures, but in places they will become straight, as you can see here, and then become serrated again. And some of the sutures are overlapping or squamous sutures, like this suture. The sutures eventually become united by bone, and this is called synostosis. Usually synostosis starts at the inside of the skull. So you can see here that the sutures are not very clear on the inside of the skull, but they are clearer on the outside of the skull, because synostosis starts from the inside to the outside of the skull. Of course, premature closure of the sutures of the skull results in deformities in the skull. The names of many of the sutures indicate the bones between which the suture in question lies. For example, here we have parietal bone and parietal bone, so the suture in between is called the interparietal suture. But in other cases, the terms are not so obvious. So one must know, for example, the coronal suture. This is the coronal suture that lies between the frontal and the parietal bones, or the lambdoid suture. This is the lambdoid suture, which is located between the occipital bone and the two parietal bones. But the names of many of the sutures indicate the bones between which the suture in question lies. For example, here, I'll give you another example here. This suture is called the frontozygomatic suture between the frontal bone and the zygomatic bone. In the anatomical position, the skull is oriented so that the inferior margin of the orbit lies in the same horizontal plane with the superior margin of the external acoustic meatus. This is called the suprameatal crest, and so the suprameatal crest lies in the same, should lie in the same horizontal plane with the inferior margin of the orbit. This is the anatomical position of the skull, and this plane is called the Frankfurt plane. To better understand the osteology of the skull, there are two ways to study these bones. Either you study the articulated bones together, and in this case, we study them in different views, or called normas. So we have here the following normas. We have the norma verticalis, which is the superior view. We have the norma lateralis, which is the lateral view, and norma frontalis, or the frontal view, and the norma occipitalis, which is the posterior view, and the norma basalis, or the basal view, and finally, we study the inside of the cranial cavity. This is the inside of the cranial cavity.